Good morning. Happy Father's Day to all the fathers out there. This is the day that the Lord has made, so let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let's lift our hearts and our voices up to the Lord. Let's sing praises to his name. Let's get lost in worship to our Father, our Heavenly Father. And we just give him all the praise and glory that he deserves. Amen. Hallelujah. So let's shout out to the Lord today. He's worthy to be praised.
I want to scream and shout from every mountain top. Your goodness goes no harm. Your goodness never stops. Your mercy follows me. Your kindness fills my life. Your love amazes me. And I speak because you are good, and I rest because you are good, and I shout because you are good. You are good to me. Oh, I speak because you are good, and I rest because you are good, and I shout because you are good. You are good.
Because you're one of your prayer this morning. Before we do, it's so good to see each and every one of you behind those masks. Amen. God bless you. Welcome to the house of the Lord. If this is your first time back with us, we welcome you. We're glad that you're here. And we give thanks and praise this morning because God is good. Because this is the day the Lord has made. And we will rejoice and be glad in it. God's presence is here to touch your life. If you would just open up and respond to Him. God has something He wants to speak to you. God has something He wants to do in your life. So would you just lift your hands all over this place? Let's go to God in prayer. Amen. Father, thank you today for your presence. God, thank you today, Lord, that you are alive. You are alive on planet Earth. You are alive in our lives. And God, we thank you and praise you that through the quickening power of the Holy Spirit, God, that we come into newness, a freshness, an experience with you, God, that changes everything. God, today I pray, Lord, that you would give us beauty for ashes. You would give us the oil of joy for mourning and sorrow. God, I pray that you would break off of us things that hinder us. Break off of us oppression and discouragement and thoughts in our mind, Lord, that hold us down and hold us back. Let us soar. Let us rise up with you this morning. God, we thank you and we give you praise in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Come on, let's worship the Lord in a way that's worthy of our God. Let's give Him praise with all our hearts in Jesus' name. Amen.
Mountains are still being moved. Strongholds are still being loosed. God, we believe. Yes, we can see it. Wonders are still what you do. Bodies are still being raised.
Yes, they are.
Giants are still being slain. God, we believe. Yes, we can see it. Wonders are still what you do. It's coming, it's coming, miracles.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
Hallelujah, Lord. We thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
There is power in the name of Jesus. Well, there is power in the name of Jesus to break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. There's power. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus to break every chain, break every chain, yes, break every chain. Come on, declare it today. Break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
At your point of need. Amen. Come on, people of God. We're the church. We arise and shine today. We let the glory of God shine upon us. We let the presence of God touch us today. Come on, all over this place. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you today. Father, we thank you for every life here. We thank you for every person, Father, that has come to your house. Lord, they're looking to you, God. They're looking to you, God, to see you, to meet with you, to experience you. God, we pray today in the power of Jesus' name that you would cause chains to fall off, God. Those things that hold us down, hold us back, those habits, those addictions, those weaknesses, Father, in Jesus' name, touch your people today. Father, in Jesus' name, set people free. God, that's who you are. That's what you do, God. Thank you, Lord. That's what you're famous for, God. All that you have done in times past, not only in the Bible, but in church history, in our history, in our church, we have seen the power of God. We have seen the glory of God. We have seen, God, what you can do. So, God, today, release your anointing in this place over every life, God. God, we pray, release your anointing in this place, your power to break every chain, to set people free, to begin a new thing, God. God, do a new thing in this place. Do a new thing in our lives, Lord. God, we thank you today, Lord. We thank you today for the moving of your Holy Spirit. We thank you for the power of God today, Lord. Thank you for each and every person here, Lord, touching each one, ministering to every family, Father, we pray in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen and amen. Before you're seated, just turn to someone, nod, wave, do whatever you can do to be socially distant. And God bless you. You may be seated at this time. Pastor Maureen is going to come. God bless you. Good to see you. This is your first time here. We want to welcome you. Can we welcome, family of God, let's welcome everyone here this morning. God bless you.
Praise the Lord. So good to see so many of you back here worshiping the Lord together. Isn't it great to be back in the house of the Lord? Amen.
Amen.
Well, happy Father's Day to all you dads.
Thank you.
And amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Father. Men of God, Wednesdays we have Life Group, and this week is actually our last week for this quarter, but we are starting up a new quarter on July 8th. Many of you saw the sign-ups coming in and have signed up, and we encourage you to sign up today if possible, and if you didn't sign up and want to, you can exit out these back doors just to sign up and out the other doors, all right? So the Life Groups are going to continue online via Zoom, and 7 o'clock, Pastors Richard and Lisa, they greet us, exhort us, encourage us for about 15 minutes, and then we go on to our own Life Groups. So if you haven't signed up, we encourage you to do that today. Just a few thoughts before I pray for the offering. You know, we share every week about tithing and offering and encourage you to give, because we don't want you to miss out on the joy and the blessing it is to give.
Amen.
God always blesses. He wants so much for your life, my life, and to give us so much, but he's looking for us to partner with him. And just an example of a life of giving is George Muller. He was the founder of an orphanage at Ashley Down in England. The orphanage housed over 10,000 children during his lifetime. In addition, Muller established 117 schools with 120,000 students that had attended, with a large portion of those students were orphans. But the amazing part of the story is that he did it all without funding and without going into debt. And why did that happen? Because he was a firm believer in the Word of God, that as you give faithfully, God blesses. And I know many of you are faithful givers, and God has blessed us, right?
Yes.
George Muller has gave his lifetime resources, and in return, God poured out his provision and his favor. And he'll do the same for us. So, in other words, George Muller gave, and God blessed. And that's how it works. When we let go of what's in our hand, God lets go of what's in his hand.
Yes.
2 Chronicles, I want to share a scripture before I pray. It's in 2 Chronicles 31, 4 and 5. And it says, King Hezekiah commanded the people who lived in Jerusalem to give the portion due to the priests and the Levites, that they might give themselves to the law of the Lord. And as soon as the command was spread abroad, the people of Israel gave an abundance of first fruits of grain, wine, oil, honey, and all the produce of the field. And they brought in abundantly the tithe of everything. And then you go down to verse 10, because once they gave, God was blessing, and they had heaps left over. So Hezekiah was asking the priest, what are these heaps? And the chief priest, Azariah, said, from the family of Zadok, he said, since the people began to bring their contributions to the temple of the Lord, we have had enough to eat, plenty to spare, and because the Lord has blessed the people, doesn't God bless you as you give? There was a great amount left over. So when you give today, your tithes, offering, mission given, capital campaign, there is an abundance of God's goodness and riches that he wants to just pour back onto us. And that's why we give. We want to bless God back, but he wants to bless us even more. So I encourage you to continue to be faithful in your giving and know that God is faithful and he's a good, good father. Amen? So you can give through the app, on the website. You can also drop it off during the week if you want to ride by and drop it off. But on the way out, we will take the offering. You can put it on in the baskets on the way out. And today, before I pray for the offering, I want to acknowledge, since it's Father's Day, we have a powerful, powerful man of God, a wonderful pastor, Pastor Richard. He's our spiritual dad. God has done so much in and through him. I've seen the growth in him over this COVID-19 and what God has done. He stretched us all, but he has been faithful as a father to pray, believe for you and I to get the most of what God has for each one of us. So I am so grateful and thankful, and I know you are. We have a gift for Pastor Richard, but we also have another special father in this house, and that is Pastor Mike.
Yes.
And we appreciate Pastor Mike so much. He has done so much during this COVID-19, has helped us with all the electronics and all beautifying this sanctuary, and we are so grateful for both of them. So let's stand together, agree with me as I pray for Pastor Mike, Pastor Richard, but also for the offering today.
Thank you, God.
Father, we praise you today, God, yes, and we thank you, God, that we can come into your house to worship you together. Father, we thank you that you are a good, good Father, and that you do bless us as we are faithful to do what you have called us to do in our giving. So God, I pray you bless your people as they give today. But God, I lift up Pastor Richard and Pastor Mike. Father, I thank you for these two men of God that are leading this church, and God, that you are doing a mighty, mighty work in and through them. Father, I pray a fresh anointing and blessing upon their lives. Father, I thank you, God, that you are doing great things through them, and I know there's greater things yet to come. Father, give them the desires of their heart as they continue to seek you, God. And Father, we thank you for these men of God that you have raised up for victory at such a time as this. And we give you the glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name, and everyone said,
Amen.
God bless you.
Amen, amen. Well, happy Father's Day to all of our fathers today. God bless you. So good to see so many of you here today. We're almost packed out this morning. Thank God. The governor for the next phase for churches starting in July, the first Sunday in July, will increase our capacity to 66%. So that had a whole lot more seats. First service was pretty full also. We thank God for that. I just want to appreciate the team, the staff that's done an awesome job in keeping the church sanitized and doing all the proper things for social distancing and keeping us all safe and healthy. I believe that we're doing a better job than Home Depot, Stop and Shop, and Walmart. No offense to them, but I think we're doing an awesome job here. So if you can go there, you can feel safe here. And we're so thankful to God for his grace. We pray for continued strength and health in Jesus' name. And everyone said,
Amen.
Amen. If you have your Bibles, you can open up to the book of Acts. If you're watching live stream, we want to welcome you. We also want to encourage all of you to just share this post. It has been tremendous how we have been able to reach literally thousands of people through live streaming. So even if you're here now, if you would just take a moment to share this, that would be awesome. I've entitled my message this morning, Stay Focused. Turn to the person next to you. Say, stay focused. I know you're on your phone, but stay focused. When I was thinking of a title for this message, I was thinking how really hard it is to stay focused in the time that we're living in. I wanted to entitle the message, Try to Stay Focused. Or, I wish I could stay focused. Or, is anybody able to stay focused? But I entitled the message, and I believe by God's grace, He's going to help us to stay focused.
Amen.
The seed thought for this message came last week when I was having my morning time with the Lord. When I was reading the scriptures and praying, I was just having a tough time focusing. I was distracted in my mind. I was distracted in my thoughts. And you know, when I pray, I like to walk. So whether it's in my house or in my backyard, as I'm praying, I'm walking. And I'm very conscious of getting my steps in. And as I'm praying, I'm finding myself getting distracted. I want to check my phone and see how many steps I'm getting in. Now, see, I'm just being honest. I'll give you an opportunity to confess your sins later. But I find that it's so easy to be distracted. We want to check the weather. How many times in the course of a day do we have to check the weather? It's not going to change the weather. Or we want to check Facebook, social media. We get texts. And then we get notifications on our phone for any app that we have allowed those notifications to come through. And here I am praying, and it's like, God, help me to stay focused. Struggling and wrestling. So what I did was I wrote that note or that thought on my notes app in my phone. And that same day, my wife and I talked with somebody who shared the same frustration. They too are having difficulty focusing when they pray and read the word. But you know what they also said? They were just having trouble in life focusing. And the reality of it is, we're living in a crazy time. We really are living in stressful times. It's overwhelming. If we're going to be honest, most of us are having a tough time focusing. Turn to the person next to you, see. Stay focused. With nonstop posts on social media, with 24-hour news updates on our phone and on TV, you notice everything is breaking news. Everything is breaking news. No matter what happens, it's breaking news. Some of us are watching just much too much news on TV. This is an intense time in our world and our life. And I'm not going to stand here and tell you it's easy.
No.
It's not easy to stay focused.
No.
So the question is there hope? Mm. Yes, there is. Yes. Amen. There is hope.
Amen.
Romans 15:13 says, May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. As we look into the scriptures today, I want the light of the Word of God to shine in your hearts. I want strength to be imparted. I want correction to be administered. I want nourishment to flow. And I want healing to be released. And that's what happens when the Word of God is shared under the power and the anointing of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I want us to look at Acts chapter 20, verses 22 to 24. Paul says, Behold, I go bound in the Spirit unto Jerusalem, not knowing the things that shall befall me there, except that the Holy Spirit testifies in every city, saying that bonds and afflictions abide me. But none of these things move me. Neither do I count my life dear unto myself, that I might finish my course with joy in the ministry which I received of the Lord Jesus to testify of the gospel of the grace of God.
Amen.
I want us to look at a man called Paul. Paul the apostle. An apostle of Jesus Christ. One who was able to stay focused. Here's a man who wrote half of the New Testament. He was a great missionary, evangelist, teacher, apostle, and arguably the greatest Christian that ever lived. What did he go through in life? Well, 2 Corinthians tells us a little bit about it. Chapter 11, verse 23. In labors more abundantly, in stripes above measure, imprisonments more frequently, in debts often, from the Jews 5 times I received 40 stripes minus one. 3 times I was beaten with rods. 1 I was stoned. 3 I was shipwrecked. A night and a day I have been in the deep. In journeys often, in perils of water, in perils of robbers, in perils of my own countrymen, in perils of the Gentiles, in perils of the city, in perils of the wilderness, in perils of the sea, in perils of false brethren, in weariness, in toil, in sleeplessness often, in hunger and thirst, in fastings often, in cold and nakedness, besides the other things which come upon me daily,
yes, right.
My deep concern for all the churches. Wow. And you think you've been through some stuff. Imagine what Paul went through. But through it all, you couldn't take away Paul's purpose. Paul's purpose was he was focused on what God had given him to do. He was able to say, none of these things move me. None of these things move me. And as I look at Paul, there's 2 thoughts that come to mind in this passage of Scripture. They're right in the text. Number 1, Paul stayed focused even though he faced uncertainty. Paul stayed focused even though he faced uncertainty. He says in that passage of Scripture, not knowing the things that will befall me. He didn't really know what the future held. And you know what I see with Paul? Paul was okay with not knowing everything. Not knowing everything about the future. Yeah, I don't know about you, but I'm a planner and I'm an organizer. I like to plan, like to strategize, you know, and chart a course and develop a plan. And, you know, I use my phone for some administrative things, but I'm kind of old-fashioned. I use the old calendar, and I'll write down everything and look at my week and look at the next few weeks and try to plan. But you know, one thing I learned during this crisis, I had to learn how to live and lead with uncertainty. Now, I don't know if there's any control freaks here. If you like to be in control of things. But this whole COVID-19, this whole crisis has thrown us for a loop because you can't control things. There's been so much uncertainty. For me as a pastor, not knowing what to do at first, and it's like, how do you do church? How do you do live streaming and videoing? How do we do drive-in church? How do we do church with social distancing? What about pastoring people that you can't see, you can't feel, you can't hear? It's been hard. It's been difficult. And think about even as a church. Understand something. Like Paul said, I received a ministry from the Lord Jesus. Every single one of us, if we call ourselves Christ followers, we call ourselves Christians, we all received a ministry. John chapter 15, verse 16, Jesus said, you did not choose me, but I chose you. And I ordained you that you would go forth and bear fruit. So God has called each and every one of us to be a part of his mission. It's called the commission. Go into all the world and preach the gospel, teaching all the nations whatsoever I have given you to observe, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And Paul had that passion. He had an understanding to do ministry, and so should we. Amen?
Yes.
Thank you for that week. Amen.
Yeah, amen.
But see, for Paul, he was able to live with uncertainty, and I don't know what ministry or missions or discipleship looks like during COVID-19 or even after. Things have changed so much. So I'm praying, God, give me wisdom. And you should be praying, God, give me wisdom. How do I stay on task? How do I stay focused? How do I keep on going even with all of the uncertainty? You see, I have had to learn how to focus on Jesus more than ever. I can't allow the voices, the pundits, the experts, and even other churches dictate or decide for me. I have to learn, and you have to learn, to trust in Jesus.
Yes.
Trust in Him. What does the scripture say? Hebrews 12:1. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Looking unto Jesus. You see, for me, again, personally, I think what prepared me during this time was my sabbatical. Not just for the rest, but because during the sabbatical, I was forced to really surrender things to God. To be away for 3 months from a church that I founded, that my heart and soul is intertwined with, and people's lives was so hard. But I had to let go. I had to trust leadership. I had to trust God. And you know what? This season has been like that. So much uncertainty. To trust God in the midst of it all. I want to ask you this morning, what uncertainty are you living with? Maybe your future looks a little cloudy. You don't quite know what it's going to be 3 months, 6 months, a year. Maybe your job situation is very uncertain. Maybe your health is a question. Maybe in some relationships there's a lot of confusion. And you have to trust God. And you see, Paul was okay with not knowing. He was okay with that. He says, I'm going to Jerusalem not knowing. Turn to the person next to you and say, I don't know everything. Matter of fact, tell them, I don't know too much. Let me tell you this. During this season, I seem to know little, less and less. Behold, I go to Jerusalem not knowing the things that will happen to me. Wow. How relevant is the Word of God? If you really read it, if you really look at it with an open heart, you realize that the Scriptures speak to the heart of the man. God knows where you're at. He knows what you're feeling. He knows what you're going through. You don't know about the future. And the reality of it is, even if we weren't in a crisis, we still don't know what a day is going to bring forth. The Bible says, what is your life? It is even a vapor. But you ought to say, if the Lord wills, if the Lord wills, I'm going to do such and such. I'm going to go to such and such a place. And you see, for Paul, he didn't know what the future held, but you know what? He knew who held the future.
Yes.
He said in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 12, I know whom I have believed in, and I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. Amen. What have you committed to God? I want you to know he's able to keep it. If you've committed it, but you know what I have found? In life, we've got to recommit it.
Oh, yes.
See, because what we do, in a figurative sense, we talk about bringing things to the altar. In other words, we talk about surrendering things to God. Give it to God. And you know what? That could even be a glib thing we tell other people. Oh, just surrender it to God. It's a lot easier when you tell other people that.
Yeah.
It's quite another thing when you have to do it yourself. When you have to surrender to God and re-surrender. See, it's not just doing it once. Sometimes we have to bring it back to God. God, I surrender my family to you. I surrender my children to you. I surrender my job to you. I surrender my finances. I surrender my career to you. Because Paul understood, you know what? He's able to keep it. And wouldn't you rather put it in the hands of Almighty God? See, I've learned that all of us, we all have different concerns. When you're 20, you're not concerned about what kind of health plan you have. When you're 20, you're not talking about what medications, you know, I gotta go to this doctor, I gotta go to that doctor. You know, and when you're 70 or 80, you're not worrying about things that 20-year-old. We're all different. But you know what? Every season of life is a challenge to trust God. To trust God. And in prayer, we do that. We entrust it to God. So Paul knew how to stay focused even when times were uncertain. And how relevant is that for you and I today? And secondly, Paul stayed focused even though he faced unpleasant circumstances. What did he say? He said, except that the Holy Spirit testifies in every city, saying that chains and tribulations await me. The Holy Spirit testifies. So in every city, so it seems that wherever he went and gathered with the church, there would be a prophetic word. There would be those who would prophesy under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit and say, Paul, you're headed for chains and imprisonment. How's that for a prophetic word? Everybody wants a word from the Lord. Is there a prophet who can give me a word? The prophecies we want to hear are, the Lord's going to bless you, the Lord's going to prosper you, the Lord's going to make you the head and not the tail, God is going to make a way for you, God is going to bless you, and praise God, we like those prophecies. Amen? How about, thus says the Lord, you're going to Jerusalem, you're going to be chained, you're going to be in prison. Hallelujah. Everybody likes that prophecy, amen? Nobody's claiming that one. But Paul, in spite of the suffering and the heartache and the pain, he says, none of these things move me. Wow. As I prepared this message, I realized with the short amount of time that we have, I'm going to have to break it up. So you want to be here next week because I want to finish this message. And it's just something that God has stirred in my heart so much to think. Paul would say, but none of these things move me. What a spirit of faith. What an attitude of faith. I don't know what the future holds, but none of these things move me. Bonds, chains, and afflictions are awaiting me, but none of these things move me. Amen. You know, in the Western world, we know so little about real persecution. As Christians, I don't say this condescending because I'm part of it. I'm part of the Western world, and we know so little about real persecution. You know, I was reading a book this past week on the end times, and the author was talking about his trips in ministry to Africa, and he talked about what happened in Nigeria. I think he said in 2004, 2005, and we talk about the systematic burning of churches, where there would be those who would literally wait till the worship service was happening, just like this. They would surround the building and purposely torture and kill everyone and burn everyone inside, men, women, boys, and girls, because of their commitment and an identification with Jesus Christ. Wow. Think about that. Persecution, suffering, being massacred. You and I have not experienced anything like that. Anything like that. Anything close to that. But you know, the Bible tells us part of following Christ involves suffering and persecution. Paul writes in 2 Timothy, he says, whoever desires to live godly is going to suffer persecution. Jesus himself said, they will deliver you up to tribulation, they will kill you, you will be hated by all the nations for my name's sake. Wow. What a difference. But what did Paul say? None of these things move me. So when we look at our lives, do we allow some of the smallest, some of the most insignificant things move us away from the course that the Lord has set for us? From following Jesus Christ. Paul was able to stay focused in spite of all that he had to face. That's humanly impossible. Unless you know, no matter what way your life turns, if your life is in God's hands, you've got a place of security. Paul said in Philippians chapter 1, "For to me to live is Christ and to die is gain." He says, "If I die, I go to be with Christ." He said, "If I live, it means I have much more fruitful labor." Could it be the number one reason for all of our distractions is because to really be with Christ and to enjoy Him forever is not our passion? Hello? I think I need to say that again. Could it be the number one reason for our distractions? Because to be with Christ and to enjoy His presence is not our passion. Because listen, distractions are shifting our attention from something of greater importance to something of lesser importance. The most fundamental and most dangerous problem is distraction is being distracted from God. Yes. Turn to the person next to you, say, stay focused. Imagine some are distracted on their phones right now. God help us. Amen. And you're not looking at the Bible. But think about it. Think about it. Our fundamental and most dangerous problem in distraction is being distracted from God Almighty. Our tendency to shift our attention from the greatest object in existence to countless lesser ones. You know what that is? That's idolatry. That's idolatry. John said in his epistle, keep yourselves from idols. And what we have in our culture, what we have in our day and our age, is that we have allowed so many idols, so many lesser objects to gain our attention and to gain our affection. And as I bring this to a close this morning, I want to challenge you with the understanding we all face distractions. We all have a difficult time staying focused. And you know, some of us, it's easier for us to be focused. But you know what? Some of us, we're distracted a lot easier. Some of us have attention deficit disorder to some degree. And I don't say that lightly in any way to make light of that or be condescending. It's just the reality of it. But you know what I have found? Our culture and social media has further exacerbated the problem. Yes. Further complicated things. To where we are a people that is so distracted by the smallest little things in life that get our attention off of God Almighty. And they are things that can really bring no lasting satisfaction to our spirit and our soul. The psalmist said, delight yourself in God. The psalmist said, Lord, you are my affection. You are my life. I worship you. I focus on you. So today, as we bring this to a close, can we repent? Can we ask God, forgive us? Forgive us for making idols out of our cell phones. Forgive us for making idols out of other things and other affections and other things that get our attention. God, you are the one worthy of my worship. Amen. Can we ask God to forgive us? And then ask God to help us. You know, God wants to help you to get focused. Because the reality of it is what you focus on, you're drawn to. Amen? Amen. Let's focus on God. Amen. Amen. Let's focus on the Lord today. Let's pray and ask God to help us to be like Paul, say, but none of these things move me. None of these things move me. I stay focused in Jesus' name. Would you stand together with me? Amen. Let's pray together. Let's be like Paul today, who stayed focused even though he didn't know what the future held. And he stayed focused even though there were some unpleasant times ahead. Brothers and sisters, we don't know what the future holds, but we know who holds the future. Amen. The closer we get to the end of human history, the greater, the more intense the spiritual warfare is going to be, the spiritual activity in the heavenly realms, the battle between light and darkness, between the forces of righteousness and the forces of evil will become much more intense. And if you don't stay focused on Jesus, you're going to miss. Amen. You're going to miss it. Amen. But God wants to help you today. Turn to the person next to you and say, God is going to help you.
God is going to help
you. God's going to help you to stay focused in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's pray together. Father, thank you today that you are the greatest affection. You are the greatest object of our affection. Lord, today I pray that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you would help us to be focused. To stay focused, Lord. God, amidst all the distractions of life, may we be able to be like Paul the Apostle, by the power and the authority of the Scriptures, to be able to say, but none of these things move me. God, I pray, Lord, for a focus on Jesus. Yes. That we would look unto Christ. Look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Lord, break off those entanglements in our minds. Break off those lies. God, I pray, Lord, you bring deliverance to people's hearts and minds that are caught up in addictions, caught up in bondages, caught up in things that are detrimental. God, break them off. Bring deliverance. Because Christ, you came to set us free. And Lord, you came to bring liberty and freedom to the captives. So today, upon the authority of your word, those that truly believe it will truly receive freedom and breakthrough, Father. God, we thank you for it. God, as we close this service, we pray a blessing over the fathers. God, we pray that you raise up men of God in this house, Lord, to lead their families, to lead ministries, to lead the work of God. Lord, that there would be men who would be sold out to Jesus, truly worshiping and loving Christ in Christ alone. God, bless all of our fathers. God, bring them to a new level this year, God. Do a new thing in their life, we pray. In Jesus' name, and everyone said, amen. And amen. God bless you. We have gifts for our fathers. You are at liberty to go. If you have not signed up for a life group, please go in the foyer and sign up. God bless you. Have a wonderful day. Happy Father's Day to all the men. Amen.